It was in a room full of starched military fatigue and power suits. A former Norwegian Minister of Immigration and Integration, Sylvie Letzdahl, detachedly ardent as she ever was, offered pleasantries to 13 constituents of Sudan's al-Bashir regime, the same responsible for both the displacement and genocide of millions, as well as the continued oppressions of current populations in Sudan. For a representative of Norway, a country whose right is left, and whose left is largely social, to spend any amount of time smiling in the faces of war criminals should be disappointing at its best and lightest. That's leagues away from the reality, as Minister Listau herself is a war criminal. Large undisclosed amounts in aid funding went directly to the al-Bashir regime at the command of Minister Listau to suffer, as Listau called it, the flood of refugees to the north, in addition to deals to return asylum seekers back to Sudan, and establish currents of information exchange between Norway and al-Bashir Sudan. It should be mentioned that at the time of the meeting, Norway was the country who had rejected one of the largest numbers of refugees coming from the Horn, West, and North of Africa, as well as from the Middle East. Not knowing the nature of the meeting, the manner in which those refugees were returned, or the conditions a number of them were subjected to, both through and upon the prospect of their return, it would be permissible for the level of cordiality having gone on between all of these diplomats to distract from the fact that the aid funding increases, quite likely discussed during that meeting, also went toward prisons to contain several of those refugees, the funding of secret police to further discourage vulnerable other citizens from leaving, and the payment of soldiers to torture and then sell many of these refugees for ransom, or, in the event that ransom did not show, then into slavery or the organ trade for less than the cost of a low-range consumer-level vehicle. Listau did this knowingly, happily, and with resolve until the end of her tenure in office. She did so in 2016 intimately as she took a 2-minute-long dip in the Mediterranean whilst wearing a full-body floating apparatus to, in her words, better understand what refugees go through. This, unlike her meeting in Sudan, was accorded for just anyone to view. Unlike her meeting with al-Bashir's constituents or her meeting in Libya, it was a stunt. In each occasion, Minister Listau, always so commanding in countenance, floated like an ice cube on a bed of hot mud, every intention clumsily rendered transparent, every flippancy made diffuse. Coalitions such as Norway's FRP, or Progress Party, the political party who is represented by Listau, and other far-right nationalist constituencies care not only to produce blockade, they also care to invalidate, to mock, and then to dispose. Stunts like Listau's provide a softening lubricant to aid, abet, and humor that desire. They've inherited the dictate determining that who laughs last possesses the power. Chinese artist Zhu Shen, the sole member and CEO of fictive Maiden Company, seems also to follow this dictate, harboring taste for stunts humoring miseries obscured. Two of Shen's works, 2006's 18 Days and 2011's Play, from Shen's solo show at Shanghai's Shanghart Gallery, were curated contiguously, side by side, at the Astrofernley Museum exhibition entitled Chinese Summer in Oslo, Norway. The more drawled of the two works, 18 Days, is a netting of photograph, sculpture, and video-based documentation, offering a take on 21st century Chinese neo-imperial expansionism through a record of Zhen's 18-day trip invading military borders of each one of the countries neighboring China, accomplished effectively using remote-controlled military tanks, a stunt. Meanwhile, play consisted of a single sculpture of a woman, racially ambiguous through her possession of features characteristic of both the Black and East Asian phenotypes, bound up using a Japanese erotic bondage technique and displayed nude apart from a feathered headdress and Amazonian seeming lip plates. The two works, produced 5 years apart, were curated together, placed in a punctuatedly definable segment of Fernley's second floor as a single curatorial phrase. At this point, this is more than stunt. Viewings of the Chinese Summer Exhibition opening event were largely unguided, and with few descriptors offering clear curatorial intentions outside of the desire to show works by artists acutely aware of their place in history, with a profound intermingling of joyfulness and unadulterated aspiration, with serious social and political questions as well as different generations caught in a productive tension between tradition and modernity. Tangles of people, art world professionals, and local elite among them were thronging through the space, making it difficult to tell if some of these tours were guided or if none of them were. Zhu Shen himself, in attempts to absolve of undue outrage, said about play, "If one looks carefully, these sculptures using erotic bondage techniques aren't completely like Black people. They actually have the bodies of Asian women. Everyone is the same. We always use some cultural inertia to observe. Upon observation, the play sculpture appears to be cast of stone or concrete. It is actually silicone. Whilst silicone solids are relatively light and low density, the repercussions for this choice are heavy, loaded, and high density on the part of the artist, and significantly more so on the part of the curators for this reason. Silicone is not a naturally occurring compound, but a hybrid polymer synthesized from pure elemental silicon and petroleum-derived hydrocarbons. The elemental silicon itself, even, must be produced via its own process of chemically extracted filtration, as does not appear in a stable form naturally. Zhu Shen's casting of the wild sculpture as fully synthetic composition rather than as naturally occurring residue was a recurring theme possessed by the other works immediately associated with play during its initial debut at the Shenhai Gallery in Shanghai. 2011's Divinity, a sister work to play, figure the artificial materials used here as prompts for false understandings in rhetorical trap that don't have the weight of historical artifact and are cursory combinations of things as insubstantial as hazily recalled Wikipedia pages. According to early responses to the works found in industry press, Zen makes errors here, failing his goal and causing unfortunate damages. Zen makes the mistake of assuming that the audience's cognitive investment in his work goes beyond topicality, treating it as an understood that those works will be properly prefaced and situated. Zen goes so far, even, to pair play with another work entitled Action of Consciousness, which posits consciousness as an organ of bias, deposition, and distortion, static in the same manner as a landfill, and as if upon death it could pop shit brown and stench in summer's heat like a leg or an arm, a lung or heart, as if the very physics of market don't dictate that artwork zens among them, vested until the art industry's valuation games rotate between hands as tenders for currency and as residue for the ledgers by which those hands signal and reinforce therein every policy under their ownership, as ready-made stereographs for the values of their holders. Zen makes an irresponsible assumption here, but an ultimately forgivable one. Yet, the error's length succeed in compound the individual installation pieces and curation, linking them together in homuncular one-two emphasis in liberal humanist facade industrial practice. Objects that experience rotational motion usually undergo visual blur, and at high speeds of rotation, intermarket based or not, there are points of stereographic saturation, glaring countenances, and superficialities far eclipse depths intended. Artworks don't simply circulate into gallery spaces, they spin, cavort, and tousle into them, as silicate oils greasing the palms of those already able to bury themselves from being rubbed red by the blues of currency and memory alike. The works play in 18 days individually, and play no mind to this. Certainly do the work of ornamenting the polities of their holders as tokens of soft recognition between conglomerates playing symbiote to one another, where financiers and benefactors trace interior to external national scale action. 18 days passes ambiguity between actor and organelle, which then trolling concepts of individuality and harmful reduction by stunting in a way similar to Listow as an analog for an entire political ordinancy. Play jaunts a wild facade against the distillatively, derivatively manufactured by accessorized and signifiers of phenotypical blackness as an operational currency with which to access a path toward a universally human ground, wherein signifiers signify only facade, and all casual passages are just that, casual, and without past or associative precedent, diminutive. These moves trigger long histories which, by the hand of Zen, lightly char, but do not truly burn away due to the plasticity of our shared world. A fold can only be wrinkled into a different fold, obscured and refigured, but never removed, regardless of whether or not its presence is even recognized. The intent to showcase artists aware, joyful, aspirant, questioning, effective conditions, each as rivetedly nuanced as they are allegedly human, signal on the part of Ashton Fern the Musée that, yes, we can all do cultural polity in exchange. As a private institution separate from the hand of statehood, we can create a stage for Norwegians from Norway to relate to PRC nationals and engage an appreciation for the core human fragilities of the other, regardless of any prior tensions on our respective conglomerate of national fronts. They use their leverage as a cultural institution to credit presentations of a largely socio-cultural liberalism among the agencies constituting each country, whether or not the actual external behaviors really warrant these credits, and placing play beside 18 days works that concede for an ambiguity between cynicism and protective facade, whilst manufacturing these concessions from as many sources of social alterity as Zen could scourge. We're seeing exhibition curators allow the actual fleshed bearers of these alterities to be the causal, casual, insulatory fodder, there to transduce currents from interior to exterior and to negotiate them anti-directionally as well. These works use ritual and stunt like Norway's very own Minister of Immigration and Integration, Sylvie Listhaug, to soften movements of precarity into theater. They prop a veneer of cultural liberalism on the fronts of both China and Norway to soften and obscure economic illiberalism, and for China specifically, to gauze over political illiberalism in the interest of culling greater economic reputability and trust, enabling greater market saturation in turn. The elephant in the room with regard to this curation lies triangulated between Norway's status as a paragon of crude oil wealth, the growing dynamic of neo-imperialist power between the PRC and Africa, wherein the former often plays ally to the latter via government-to-government special trade deals offering the latter economic and infrastructural handouts out of centuries-old post-colonial squalors in exchange for due extractive liberty, and Norway's significant investment in PRC stock in the interest of gaining future returns that remedy declinations in North Sea oil supply and declinations in the largest sovereign pension fund on the planet that GPFG, which is Norway's sovereign oil fund. Essentially, it is of great interest to Norway to aid in Chinese economic empowerment to keep the GPFG in position to continue to benefit from PRC petrol dependency, just as Saudi Arabia and other Persian Gulf countries do, and largely at Africa's social expense. Read beneath the pretense of this context, the works Play, 18 Days, and possibly the entire Chinese summer exhibition produce curatorial impacts having less to do with celebration of a joyful aspirant human commons and more to do with that commons instrumentalization in the interest of sustaining fiscal buoyancy in the face of international pressures, or at the very least, that commons potential to do so. What assumes visibility upon this instrumentalization's instance is a labor acting intentionally or non-intentionally to minimize the damages, frictions, and mistrustings coming in response to the peaceful rise of the PRC, a peaceful rise that carries alongside it, positively, the BRI, and a symbolic victory over market-driven neoliberalism, which circumvents the organizing pillars of whiteness, lightness, and unmitigated linear, high-gradient progressions of technologies, allowing pillars easy transmission, appropriation, and adoption. Dangerous, however, have been the potentials for PRC-driven capital operations to commit abuses in the throes of their circumvention, which have been extensively documented, with the excerpts of which occurring in countries of the African continent. And in lieu of a qualitative whiteness being the driver for market salience and legibility, the presence of a Zhonghua Minzu Wei Dao Fu Xing, or great rejuvenation of the Chinese nation, instead centering PRC Zhu Sanguini's right of blood citizenship as the fulcrum for market salience and lateral mobility. This leaves all others, pointed out by Zen, in the straits of a precarity greater than terms of ethnic and political adjacency to Zhonghua Minzu. Multilateralism's go to die, and the depicted alterities here signal that. In the art industry, artworks are usually singularly instantiated objects, and one or only a few of a kind. One institution says that a work is suitable to be in the market, and its constituted narratives are suitable to affect the public realm, whether or not it is possible to be viewed in public space. It eventually moves on to the next holder, the next institution, and so on, with each of these entities' vault to hold or display the work, serving as an affirmation of the work's constituted narratives. Within any locality of material, be it a locus of industry, as is of concern to us, or other relational situations, there are particular behaviors transpiring externally to said locus which frame and encourage predispositions of hospitability particular to that discrete locus, dimension, niche, place, area. Like particles of a shimmering ash taking passage with the winds, objects moving through these localities each exhibit their own inertias and make their own kinds of indelible collisions to the terrain. Particles may be small, but each carry causational validity and variable density, enabling transductions and translations of energy at multiple scales. Particles leave old loci and come back again, finding old lands with new mounds, new wrinkles, and new decrepities with prior flourishes as ruins, and flowers singing in weak crevices. They feed deeper markings onto the children of consequences already theirs. Ejections are full abjurations and blockings of returns and adjacencies. Palpable unvotes change nothing of the soils of the, as they have become, nor address the byproducts of prior events and depositions. Circulating objects spectralize into tissue, rotating across full textures and niche and loci and multiplicity. When an artwork moves between institutions, it circulates. Seen cross-industrially, its movement is more like rotation. And under this pretense, what of the stunts presented by Minister Listhaug objectionable had her movements been to the point that she was finally pressured to step down from her position, but unfortunately only after having successfully carried out several witches of the Norwegian FRP Progress Party. Through an increased pressurization of the potential penalties associated with Nordic facing immigrations. More objectionable, however, is what it took to create the sufficient pressures. A Facebook post reminding the anti-immigration sentiments of the 2011 July 22nd Utøya massacres, where casualties were mostly Norwegian. Committed in the interest of discouraging social leftists and encouraging right-wing extremists to take more graduated action. Why would it take a more overt, humorless political meme to make the stances encouraged by Listhaug and the FRP Progress Party? Unambiguous in Listhaug's presence, unambiguously unacceptable when the full gravity of those same sentiments were made clear 2 years prior during her stunt in the Mediterranean and during occasions in excess to that. The point here isn't that ethnic Norwegians consider themselves in their social, national, racial commonality to make them implicitly more valuable than anyone else. It is to say that had there been less desensitization to black alterity and black death, then Listhaug would have received the adequate pressures to exit her post at least 2 years prior. Lives would have been spared in a dimension of complexity in approaching the refugee crisis would have seen mitigation. At the time of Sen's production of Play and of the PRC's elimination of ties with Norway, the PRC had been sourcing only a relatively light percentage of its oil for Norway's North Sea region still. It did so in consistency. Hu Jintao, who was the leader of the PRC at the time, claimed a pursuit of a peaceful rise to power, a statement that was rephrased as a peaceful development in order to ally international concerns around the PRC's oil diplomacy and to sustain its pragmatic and low-key approach in securing oil imports. A low-scale transduction of energy from Norway provided palpable benefit to the PRC's public interest by forming a basis for softer, only obfuscatedly crude liaisons, representing a style of subtle support largely particular to the PRC via its government-to-government market irrespective dealing. Concurrently, the PRC has been known to provide a similar style of support to al-Bashir's Sudan in terms of diplomatic backing, a country that is among the few which furnished more than 50% of the PRC's energy needs at the time of Play's production. With the kinds of advancements the PRC has made in developing effective renewable energy technologies throughout the 2010s, it is apparent that this dynamic is not one that is especially attractive or desirable for representatives and constituents of the PRC, but one temporary and largely implicit to the math of the PRC's ordinancy. One thing among many things revealed to us by that math, particularly through the series of connections between the PRC, Norway, and in this particular case, al-Bashir Sudan, is that for the social futures of the PRC and Norway to be viable, there has to be a constructor serving as a domain for the absorptive and provisional interchange and material decay, the inputs and the outputs for each benefiting constituency. The al-Bashir regime itself, well among them. Arguably, for Norway, that constructor would be Islam, with practitioners of the faith having been the grand target for the country's right wing in the interest of preventing transmission of the cultural impacts of Islamic Sharia law, as well as in the interest of absconding some of the psychic dissonances arising from having human embodiments proxying the specter of financial competition from abroad. Functionally, however, what could that constructor for absorptive and provisional interchange be, and material decay be, other than blackness, and concept as much as manifest. The specter aforementioned uses it as such, as an automatic first-line barrier and nitrogeny, and willingly did so in the special transaction first mentioned here, the special transaction of bodies first mentioned here. It takes this form in variable gradations and prevalences like heme at first glance, but much more like a nitrogeny ironic, reliant on processes of alchemical negrito and decay to produce transformation, mutation, fossilization, time, and narrative. That dynamic, the rendering of skin into hide, a phrase posited eloquently by artist Rendon Johnson, is how we produce production itself. It is the origin point and fulcrum of techno. When we see Zen's work instrumentalized by the curation at Fernley, we see trinkets of hide hiding nothing at all, everything nude and crude, faces daubed black with hydrocarbonic byproduct, shaded just so in graphite, bubbled up and baked in all the right places temporarily and just due to the implicit math of it, while open systems obsolesce for efficient ones, finally. And the backdoor to those efficiencies abstract closed system humanities, leaving old illegibilities and violent illicit wealth excised and claimed, the veritable absorptions, composites, records of transients, absolutely do not just burn away ashen to the wind's full mercy. They dilute into extremity, slaved down to a function frame, as the earth for other performances. Blacknesses and plasticities of time become played out and simulated into non-native frames as imported objects, dislocated into full-on exotics, caricatures, memes, reproductions. They signal movement rather than any kind of absent, casual condition, or dynamic staticism. As a non-proliferate of that movement, to offer up proliferated hide, asylum, fossil, or refuge for your own survival, jest, plaything, resident, or credit, it's gross.